In a previous video, we took a look at how you can slick up the action on a Rossi R92 rifle by refinishing key components and replacing the stock springs with an aftermarket set. In part 2 of this series, we'll focus on further quality of life improvements that can be made, including how to smooth out and lighten the loading gate, shorten the magazine tube spring, and upgrade the follower to further enhance performance. As you can see here, loading the R92 could definitely stand to be smoother. The stiff loading gate coupled with an overpowered magazine spring quickly served to complicate things, particularly when there are already a few rounds in the tube. Further compounding this is the tendency for the sharp edges of the loading port to snag or bite cartridges and fingers. Starting with the magazine tube, let's see what we can do to address this. We'll begin by laying the rifle out on a flat, clean surface. Next, we'll use a slot screwdriver to remove the magazine plug screw. Keep in mind, the plug's under quite a bit of pressure and needs to be held securely during removal. With the plug removed, we can go ahead and take out the spring. Don't be surprised if the follower fails to live up to its name. You'll likely need to upend the rifle for it to drop out. Shown here is the plastic stock follower next to a replacement stainless steel model. Although plastic is used in a lot of magazine followers, it does have a tendency to wear and bind more than metal. This stainless unit will last virtually forever without any risk of cracking or wearing with age and use. Next, we'll move on to the magazine tube spring. One of the little-known facts about these is that most manufacturers produce a single size of spring, which is then used for multiple different length tubes. As the manufacturer's first priority is always going to be function, the spring is subsequently sized to work with the largest potential mag tube that it could be installed in. In the case of Rossi, they make the R92 in 16, 20, and 24-inch barrel lengths. In this case, we're working with a 16-inch barrel, meaning the stock spring was actually designed to accommodate a substantially larger mag tube. The result is an overpowered spring that offers far more resistance than is mechanically necessary for operation. To lighten this up, we'll go ahead and trim or dock the spring down to a more appropriate length. Preferences on spring tension will of course vary from person to person and, more importantly, caliber to caliber. It's also worth noting that while an overpowered spring does make loading more challenging than it needs to be, an underpowered spring can actually cause problems with chambering the last few rounds. As with any permanent modifications we make to a firearm part, the key here is to remember it's easier to cut more material off than it is to add back on. In the case of this roughly 24-inch spring, we'll begin by removing 10 coils, or about 2 1/4 inches. Next, we'll apply some light oil, then reinstall the follower, spring, and plug. Using some dummy rounds, we'll perform a function test to try out the newly docked spring. There's definitely a noticeable improvement, however, it's still a little tenser than I'd like, so we'll go ahead and remove another 5 coils and test it again. With a new overall length of a little over 20 inches, this magazine tube spring is much lighter, but still cycles reliably using .38 special ammo. Depending on your caliber and needs, docking the spring may also allow you to fit an additional round. In my case, although it wasn't enough to expand my capacity for .38 special, it did allow me to fit one extra 357 Magnum. Moving on to the loading gate, we'll begin by disassembling the rifle. Since we already covered this pretty thoroughly in part 1, I'm not going to repeat it here. However, if you haven't already seen it, I'd highly recommend you at least review it for this part. Link in the description below. With the rifle on its left side, we'll use a slot screwdriver to remove the spring cover screw. With that done, the spring cover, or loading gate if you prefer, should drop free and can be easily removed. As you can see here, the gate's essentially integrated into a leaf spring. Shown here is the stock angle of the spring as it arrived in my rifle. Some folks will suggest you bend the leaf. I really don't recommend that as it can mess up the alignment. Instead, we're going to go ahead and narrow the leaf vertically to lighten it up. Currently, the leaf has a height of around 0.24 inches. Our goal here is to reduce the strength without compromising it and without introducing any weak points that may be susceptible to cracking or fatigue. In order to accomplish this, we'll aim to remove about 0.8 of an inch, or roughly 1/3 of the material, in a curved pattern. Using a Sharpie, we'll start by marking 0.8 in the center. Next, using a round object such as a large can or lid from a jar, we'll trace out a curved line that stays within the boundaries of the spring portion designed to flex. The curvature is absolutely key, as it'll yield a gradual flex that more evenly distributes force, avoiding focusing too much pressure on any one point. This will help prevent the spring from fatiguing or cracking over time and use. From here, We'll use a Dremel tool and grinding bit to begin removing material. We'll work slowly, pausing frequently to check our progress. This is not only to ensure we stick to the marked area, but also to prevent the spring from overheating, which may have an adverse effect on the way it functions. With the basic cutout complete, we can now switch to a rigid felt bit and some abrasive polish to clean up and smooth out the edges. And that looks pretty good. Again, note the smooth, gradual reduction in material. We'll apply some light oil to the surface to prevent any corrosion and set the spring aside. Finally, it's time to address the loading port itself. As mentioned earlier, the edges of both the outside and particularly the inside are very sharp. Polishing these down will help eliminate ammunition binding during loading, particularly the last few rounds where there's extra tension from the magazine tube spring. Once again, we'll use a Dremel with felt bit and some abrasive metal polish to begin softening up the edges as well as the internal perimeter. It's worth noting, the object here is to polish, not grind, so we're letting the abrasive do most of the work with very little additional pressure. Apologies in advance for the poor image quality, but what you're seeing is the inside of the R92's receiver. More specifically, the internal edge of the loading port. Note the extremely sharp angle. This is what's biting your cartridges and why they're getting scratched up. We'll use the same tool, bit, and abrasive to resolve this. However, in this instance, we actually will be applying a bit more pressure. Moving back and forth will gradually reduce and soften the angle. It's difficult to show, but you should be able to feel it tactily. Now that the first round of polishing is complete, we'll switch to an even finer jeweler's rouge for a second pass. This will help to smooth out any scratches from the abrasive, as well as further polish and hone the surface. As with the previous example, extra attention needs to be paid to the internal angle, as it's by far the worst offender here. With the last of the polishing complete, it's time to get this rifle back together. We'll start by sliding the loading gate in through the port, then using one finger to pinch it in place against the receiver. Next, we'll line things up and perform a simple function test, then reinsert the spring cover screw with the slot screwdriver. We'll perform a second function test to ensure the gate opens and closes smoothly without any obstruction. As with the disassembly, the reassembly is covered in part 1 of this series and will not be repeated here. With the rifle fully reassembled, we'll perform one last function test. With the use of some dummy ammunition, you should be able to see just how much smoother and simpler it is to load the R92. The loading gate moves much more freely, cartridges slide into place without sticking or snagging, and the magazine spring offers far less resistance, especially on the last few rounds. As with the changes demonstrated in part 1 of the series, these modifications make a substantial impact on how simple and fun this gun is to shoot. At less than $30 for the follower and an hour of your time, these are low-cost, simple upgrades that make a big difference.